Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, wherever you may be in the cosmos. It's Rocken Larry Locken with Pleiadian Express Productions, Pleiadian Talk. I am very honored on this Saturday evening here on the Oregon coast to have as my guest the great Julien Wells. We're going to talk a little bit about the realm and how they're starting to integrate with everything and come into our reality more and more. And Julien, I'd like to thank you for being here, brother. How are you doing tonight in Seattle?
I'm doing good. Your microphone is acting a little bit muted at times again, but I can hear you all right, but just keep your mouth to the microphone as best you can, I suppose. So for everybody that's joined us on the Google Hangouts, if you could drop your video and mute yourself as well, and that would improve the feed for everybody, improve the quality. I've already muted Jacqueline and Lil just in the last couple moments. But so where did you want to start in particular? I'm going to assume some people have listened to the 5 or so minute discussion we had about setting up this show in the first place. But was there a spin from there you wanted to start? Maybe a first question spinoff?
Yeah, I think that this subject is coming more and more to the forefront, and the conversation that we had when you were talking about the integration of these realms being more and more a part of our daily life, that's the impression I've got, that the veil is part of the veil, and I don't want to hear your take on that, and whether this is an area that is as far as, is this something you're starting to explore more and more?
Yeah, so as probably a couple of people who know me, I had an experience in Shasta about 2 years ago on the solstice where I came across my first memories of seeing a fairy. And it wasn't just one fairy, it was actually a couple. Total of three, but initially just one. And it was a very perplexing experience that I've pulled together over time. But not a whole lot of more information has come out until more recently when I began asking questions about it again to myself, to Pleiadians, to my guides. My two primary guides are the sun and the earth, as Gaia, and they began explaining a couple things a couple months back. In fact, more than a couple months back, maybe like 9 months back or so, about what was transpiring and what we were coming to see in our near future, not our far future, but our near future, and that there are other. We're going to call them realms, but they're also understood as dimensions of perception that are not functionally within the exact frequency that we're in. We're in a very limited band of frequency with regards to all the frequencies that Gaia provides. If you think of a home, you can think of Gaia as a home. And like a house, and during your development from being a little baby to being an adult, you go through many different levels of understanding what that home is about. And even when you get much older, unless you become like a contractor, you may not even know what is holding the home together. Now, you may not understand anything about plumbing. You may not know if your walls are made of concrete or wood. Or drywall or something. So there's a lot of things that are unknown, but you still get to experience them. So this is the what you're referring to as the veil, which is the place where information is not fully clear. It's like a fogginess of understanding. But in truth, when you connect more and more, and you listen more and more to your higher self. And as well to guides if they're communicating with you, you can begin to access broader knowledge and become more sensitive to that. In my particular case, for those who are not aware of me, I did deliberately train in building my sensitivity and my confidence in the information. I've been doing sessions for people for a couple years now, but even before then, I practiced feeling energy and developed the ability to see energy, and that contributed to my being able to perceive my experiences in a different way than what I might say is how I used to, in a strictly 3D sort of way, my experiences in Shasta with the fairies. Now, I've not only seen fairies in Shasta, but I've seen a variation of fairy called a sprite out at Nia Bay about 1.5 years ago. And I've also communicated with lots of beings telepathically, and which would be not visible to my regular eyes, and so I've just sort of been on that path. And coming back to your question with regards to these dimensions, if you can understand, well, it's pretty easy to understand the Fey realm, which a lot of people have understood as sort of like the fairy tale realm, where lots of fairy tale stories seem to have a basis in being true, like a world where magic exists and leprechauns and fairies and trolls and dragons and unicorns and things like that all exist. Well, they do have a dimension dedicated to them that is fairly collected. It is in they all mostly live together. Mostly is still relative. I mean, I can go into talking about dimensions, but maybe I'll hold off onto that until there's a place in time that it's going to start to make sense. But what's coming up relatively soon, as in within years, and in some cases the veil is thinning in particular areas on the planet, and it's going to get to a much more obvious place of that by the end of the year or around the end of the year. And so there are areas we'll call them portals that are bridges between the realms. And this allows people to sort of like have a foot in both sides. So you can have a foot in the Fey realm and you can have a foot in the Earth realm. And the way that this is possible is that there are conscious beings and conscious energies, such as Gaia specifically, that hold two realms together so that in a way that your eyes and your five senses can understand them. So for instance, you might have heard about the fairy circles. These are a circle of toadstools in the woods. You're familiar with that knowledge?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so they are, you might say, like a teleporter to the realm, but essentially when you step within there, and one that has been programmed for such reason, is going to be one that grows naturally. And typically, it's going to be toadstools that have white spots on a red mushroom. That's the typical type, but it doesn't have to be exactly. That's just the most typical type. When you stand in there, you will be in their world as well as yours. There's lots of stories that talked about how fairies sort of messed with humans when they did that, only because fairies don't have a direct relationship with humans. And so in their world, they're empowered by what they understand the rules are and what they're allowed to do and what sort of governing conscious energies allow them to live and breathe and be themselves. And so when you walk into that realm, if you're basically someone that that basically is spoon-fed their reality and does not actually own a degree of their understanding of the reality, well, then they're going to go in quite helpless. and the fairies don't understand not being able to help yourself. Because honestly, they see humans as being having a vast amount of consciousness and a vast amount of intellect. It's almost like if you imagined like a god, or like you know, some sort of stereotypical god-like being, like a giant you know, sphinx showing up, or a giant you know, glowing being that was 10 foot tall and looked like Zeus. You'd be surprised if they demonstrated a lack of being able to do whatever they wanted. You know, you'd say, well, it looks like you could do a lot of things, but how come you can't control this? How come you can't control that? How come you're not an understanding of this? And many of the gods in our, you know, even Roman or in Greek mythology, or, yeah, and even Viking mythology, it's not mythology. These beings exist, but they're just another focused type of human, another focused type of consciousness that, that generally acts like human. Now, the stories that get passed down are from a human perspective in terms of how they're shared, so we can't ever really understand what it's like to be in their shoes. But when we have an interaction, we have a personal experience. We get something out of what we're having with them, and they're having their own experience out of what they're getting from us. And as strange as the individual can be, the more unpredictable the experience can be. And that's, you know, that leads to fears and whatnot. And same thing with extraterrestrials, you know, landing and stuff. There's fears because you really don't know what to expect. You don't know what their proclivity is. You don't know, you know, why they're there or why it's happening. So a lot of these things are meaning to be cleared up, as in we're meaning to understand more. What the fairy realm, well, it's not even just a fairy realm, we'll just call it an in-between world that is another reality of Earth that has a much larger open sphere of possibilities and relationship with Gaia. And there are people that, that have had these before, and they have them incidentally, but this is literally going to be a spreading of this dimension reconnecting and merging with ours. This is going to happen in pockets, so it's going to like spread out. It's going to be in a similar way to like a cloud, like when you're inside a cloud and you can't see very far, but when you're on the outside, you can identify the size of the cloud from the outside. And so there's going to be this sort of what you understand as the veil, will be this inability to sort of make sense or to understand or to remember what's going on. But internally, and within the connection that we have to our higher beings, all this information is there. So we're not actually going with a full disconnect of what's going on. In order to begin to understand what's going on, you'll want to be in your heart, you'll want to be still, you want to be listening, you'll want to know how to shut down the mind, not completely, but shut down the mind to a level of volume that it is not acting in panic. When the completely, that's because it can't cope. You know, that's when you know, you lose your memory, you're wondering what happened, you say something felt like it was a dream, or it was like a dream that seems so real. This occurs oftentimes when you're waking up from a dream and actually participating in other realms and other dimensions. All those other realms and other dimensions are lighter in vibration than ours, and so a lot of the consistency is not that important. But we do bring the human mind there, and the human mind does analysis. In the moment, we're caught up with the vibrations and the experiences there, so we don't necessarily judge it. But it's usually when you wake up and you say, I think I had a weird dream, or there was weird stuff in there, you know, things that wouldn't work in the human Earth 3D realm. You know, like I was flying, or all of a sudden the scene changed. And you know that doesn't happen here, but when you're into the broader places, you get to realize that, hold on a moment, I'm in but Larry has gotten booted from the group. So I'll just hold on just for a second and see if he can jump back in. But while I'm in this holding position, if anybody does have questions, there is a Q&A section of Google's Plus to the left. It says Q&A. It's not the chat. And if you had questions, I would drop them in the Q&A if you want me to answer them or Larry answer them. I still have quite a bit more to share, and I want to make sure that that Larry's able to get in and listen so he can answer in context. He's just let me know in Facebook that he got booted out of the room. So is everybody able to hear all right? I noticed earlier one of you mentioned that it's a bit hard to hear. Great. All right, Larry, you're back. Thanks, Rachel. So he's trying to get back in. I'm just getting a couple messages from him, and then we'll continue. But on a side note, I've never done a Google Hangout, so I'm really liking this format. I'll possibly do more of these, learn a little bit more how it works and how the recording works and stuff. Well, what I'll do for the moment while Larry's wanting to come in is does anybody else want to ask a question in the room or come live and speak in voice? Because I believe you can just unmute yourself. Hello, G. G. Okolov. Your microphone is unmuted. It looks like that questions are not able to be I believe they need to be confirmed. So Larry, is that you jumping in? Because well, I'm not sure how the the Q&A works, honestly. So I guess questions just put in the chat. It will be fine. Oh, your microphone is giving me a chipmunk rendition of your voice, Larry. So I'm guessing you'll want to restart. Yep, I can't understand you at all. Well, I'm just going to check with Larry to see if the system still allows to record while he's away. Sorry for the technical difficulties, everyone. I promise next time I get in here, I'll be a little bit more familiar. Yeah, I'm also hoping that when this recording comes out, it comes in a format that we can crop and edit so we don't have to work over all this dead air when it goes to YouTube. All right, Larry, if you can hear me, just give me an auditory response. Okay, he's confirmed with me that he'd like me to keep going. So I'm not sure exactly where I left off, but essentially there are several phases involved in the reconnection of other dimensions, and it's not just the Fey realm. It also includes realms such as the densities or perceptual dimensions in which the Pleiadians, amongst other ET races, are going to be able to merge and connect with us on a much more obvious and clear level. There will be, as there already are, Pleiadians that are walking on Earth, that are acting like humans for the most part, and if you identify one as being Pleiadian, they will, from what I'm told, they will identify themselves and confirm that they are. However, They are quite aware that it's not the functional time for Pleiadians to be present, and so they basically come and go as they need in terms of having a visible presence on the planet. They have the capacity to go back to a density vibration that is more comfortable to them. But if you want to understand a little bit more about density and vibrations and how the planet offers multiple, really the density and vibration is a matter of your personal resonance. Now, your resonance is a makeup of multiple continuous energetic programs that your body is reflecting in the kind of way we call beliefs. Like you have a belief in gravity, so you exist in an environment that promotes gravity. Now, in the Fae realm, they have a completely different relationship and a different vibratory pattern, so they actually float. They're basically an isolated gravity place, and as long as they're awake, they don't fall to the ground, and their wings are actually tools to actually guide them. So it's kind of like if you were weightless and you were inside of a space shuttle in outer space, you can use wings to sort of like fan yourself around the place. So they have that capacity similar to a couple other animals that exist here in 3D, such as bees. Bees are actually weightless as well. While their wings are beating, it creates and leads to a vibration with their specific rate of fluttering that also connects with an internal, I want to say it's a larynx, but it's a type of device which promotes a very specific vibration that allows them to escape a gravitational pull. I know it can be a bit, you know, confusing to get into all those sorts of little facts, but what has come through is over time is that there are so many corners of this world containing experiences that we know nothing about. You know, we imagine that we know everything that's on Earth as humans, and that you know, the only place to explore anything is to go to the, you know, the depths of you know, of the jungle, or to go to other planets. That fundamentally there isn't that much to explore. But in fact, once the bridging of dimensions occurs, as you and I, listening to this, and myself, begin to incorporate vibrations that include the Fae realm in a very real sense, we will begin to have an experience where it just opens up, where we open up to a completely new world of consciousnesses that are there, like creatures, like leprechauns and fairies and what have yous, things of legend, and we'll begin to have more and more relationship with them. I mean, it's not going to start off where you're necessarily going to start moving in with your local leprechauns. It's going to be more of a case where your reality, as in you being a bridge of multiple realities, as you have multiple vibrations within you and multiple beliefs and multiple, you're basically a combination of lots of grounded vibrations that you develop, you know, from the point of your birth. As you begin to merge these other realms, you will begin to observe those other realms. And incidentally, yes, you may have occasional experiences that are prepared by your higher self and your guides, so that you have an experience that helps you, you know, kick down the door of limitations, and so you end up with experiences that you can observe, you can measure, you can look at as functional and not something that is dedicated to only a dream state. So when you look at bridging of dimensions, it really involves taking heed of what is possible. And of course, you know, the whole system of deciding what is possible, and trying to decide what is possible is what humanity has been going through for centuries, and wanting to get a grasp on more and more. Only in these times, some exceptional experiences are letting us know, especially those probably here listening to this, that that there is more out there. And so the concept that there is more out there is paramount in our ability to explore what is out there, is first needing to be able to open to that. And so we'll go through step-by-step deprogramming experiences. And that will be up to the mind, your mind, to basically give way to these as being of value or not of value. And since the mind is involved in grounding the truth and grounding vibrations of which you will be a match to, you're really talking about a relationship with your mind here, with regards to both the idea of ascension and the idea of bridging into vibrations that that lead you into a reality that you actually prefer more. I know that there's this slave species concept where this cabal or Illuminati is running the show, but they're really more in a position of offering that, much like our parents offered it for a temporary period of time. So although it appears the status quo was established and run, you know very well after leaving your parents' home and leaving your parents that that you had to begin weighing what was important to you going forward. And so this is kind of what we all get to go through and why we're here at this point in time, as this is the point in time to be here to have lots of reflections as in indicators in our outer reality that let us know that we're in balance with this continuing shift. Now, that's a whole other subject, being in balance, but I'm just checking in here. Larry's left a message, and I want to read it here. Okay, he says, I'm back. A couple points wants to ask. As I mentioned, pockets or portals in some areas of the planet. Are you there, Larry?
Yeah, I'm here. Okay. I wanted to just touch on that. I know that you've covered so much, and I got to apologize for the technical glitch, but you had mentioned these portal pockets all over the planet, and do you get a sense from your contacts or anything where some of those may be? And I have a second part question to that, because I want you to run with these. You mentioned that fear of UFOs that people have, the landing, the unknown. I'm wondering, do you think it's something a little bit more deeper ingrained in us? Like, we're so scared, I think, innately of, or a lot of people have life out there, or the fact that there's infinite life out there. But it's just kind of strange, you know, and I'd be curious to what your take on those.
Sounds great. So, the first question, and so hold that other one in context when it comes. When we get to the second question, but the first one with regards to specific locations, yes, there are locations in China, in Great Britain or England, specifically in the Scotland and Ireland regions, and there are a couple areas in Northern Europe that's not, I want to say, in the Belgium, Northern Belgium area. There are a couple areas in Russia. And on the border of Iran, I don't know what the north border of Iran is, but it's the north border of Iran. There are a couple areas that are very, very small points, but there's a couple areas around that Middle East area that are very, very both worlds at the same time. There's a couple areas in the Sahara, but they're not really accessible at this point. Because there's actually some sort of need I'm getting that that sand be removed in order to get to those portals. There's a whole bunch of them in the Amazon. There's also several in South America, on sort of like the mountain range in Chile, and there is a couple in, well, there's one specifically at Uluru in Australia, and there's a couple in the Pacific Northwest, but these are all not fully open, which means that they are open when the energy is specific to support that at different times. And so what I mean by that is during different times of the year, there's going to be different astrological alignments that are going to promote the energy for different ones opening. And those who feel synchronistically pulled to be in these places will begin to have opportunities to have one foot in both places, so to speak. Now, I want to let you know that these are just the portals. These are just tools to make it easier to experience the other coalesced realm. And oftentimes, in order to have experiences that are not dependent on the portals themselves, you'll want to, well, we'll just say most people are not ready for this. I mean, you know, maybe one out of a million or something like that already has the capacity for this. But a great deal of this bridging is occurring as DNA is turning on within our bodies. This DNA includes genetics from lineages that are related to things like fairies and elves and Pleiadians and Arcturians and Andromedans and all these sorts of lineages that make up our blood, that were involved in the seeding and developing human here on Earth over a great deal of time. So these DNAs are, there's no such thing as junk DNA, there's literally enlivening DNA. So when all the DNA is actually active, that is the point at which you're, I guess you can just interpret yourself as a cosmic being with no limits or bounds, and take your last look at everything that is physical and limited, and tend to move on from there. But there is a great deal of living as a physical human, as a physical being that is a coalescing of multiple light energies known as DNA, to have an experience that bridges things you know that we've seen in mythology with things that that we choose to invite. Where you're aware of the law of attraction, but it's really fundamentally quite deep with regards to how every speck of existence has a purpose in that. And when we look at it, it's nigh impossible to try to make heads or tails of it, because this is such a really good mixture of a lot of information of what we're attracting. So in many ways, if you study dreams, you get involved in studying the symbology of different things in dreams, like, you know, water is emotion and speaks to specific emotions. You know, everything from crossing water means you're crossing through and bridging emotional concepts. You know, if it's raining, that has a meaning, and lots of other things that you might find in a dream. These all have a physical presence and importance in your five senses world. You live in a five senses organized world. Is somebody's mic unmuted? Lil, I'm going to mute you for a moment. And Lil, could you mute your line?
Okay. There we go.
Okay. So, I lost my train of thought.
Well, yeah.
Well, the point that I was getting to the point of making, was that we still have growing to go through. We still have our DNA to be to continue to be lit up. And so we're going to go through the programs we'll call beliefs, or even subtler than that, we'll call them subconscious beliefs, and we'll begin to make decisions on changing those. And they can only be changed really when you have your heart in it, you know, when you actually want it to change, when you actually feel that it's going to feel right that it changes, so that you're putting that energy, that love, that that passion, that that place of inner presence gets to pour in the energy that comes from that and from the passion and from your heart. And when that pours in, then that has a greater capacity to rewrite beliefs that are embedded at a subconscious nature. And the subconscious nature is part of the body, as we're mind, body, and spirit. We have the mind, we have the body, which is which acts on an intuitive and sort of like an autopilot type of way, the way that your breathing works on autopilot when you're not thinking about breathing, and the way that your heart works on autopilot, and the way that your body, you know, operates mechanically. And then you have your mind, which is everywhere that you begin to consider what is a functional value. And then you have your spirit, which, of course, you also get to communicate through and identify with your emotional spectrum, letting you know, you know, how you're doing with regards to aligning those three perspectives and states of intention. So when we look at this level of progress towards getting to the Fey realms, all this is accounted for. And the more that you begin to loosen up to a lot of possibilities, we'll even just say call them possibilities, you'll begin to find that your environment starts to give you symbolic information, much like in the dream place. But, you know, functionally, the physical world, which we understand, which is when we're not dreaming, is, you know, 1,000 times more complex, because we have like 1,000 dreams coalesced into one space. So in a dream, you may, you know, take note of, oh, I was in my room, but you don't take note of everything that was in your room. You just know that that felt like your room, and that's enough. It's just to feel that that's it for you to operate from that place. But when you're in your physical room, you say, well, actually, I had a lot of things in my room. I have this, that, and the other, and I've got plenty of clutter. All those have a function for you. And the function is always in context to your awareness, which you can choose by directing your awareness to it, or your non-awareness. So if it's in a non-awareness, that means it's in the background. It's just, you know, one piece in the puzzle of the tapestry that you're living. And, you know, whether you focus on one piece of the puzzle in that moment or time, you know, is as relevant as you choose to direct your mind and direct your focus. So hopefully that's not way too confusing. And if you wanted to, we can get to that second question, or we can spin off from questions from there.
Yeah, you know, Julien, what I was thinking about the whole time that I'm hearing you say this, I'm thinking about empowerment. And isn't this really about standing in their own power and having their empowerment to acknowledge these realms and to do what they want to do? I know you mentioned branching off from your parents. They take care of you until a certain age, and you go out there. And I think we get this preconceived notion that we've got to live up to what they want to do. They want to want, but it's really about standing in your own power. Does that resonate at all? Or?
Well, yes. And by the way, your video is on, and it's giving a really wild show of you walking around. If you wanted to knock off your video for extra bandwidth, or maybe give us a view of your face here, because
that's not me though.
Is that someone else?
Yeah, it's got to be somebody else. Yes, mine's off.
Okay. Well, anyways, anybody that's on the line, it would be great if you turned off your video, so that was slightly just distracting for everybody that's that's following what's going on and to not see it as in context. So what was your question again?
Yeah, my question was basically the empowerment thing. I mean, you had mentioned earlier, you know, once we branch off from our parents, it's time to kind of do our own thing. But at the same time, I've always felt like in society we have to try to live up these expectations. But it's about empowerment. All this is about empowerment and understanding your own power.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So many people are going to go through what you call the conspiracy theories, right? Because they lead to this place where there's a lot of indicators to let you know that there's been a controlling, organizing body with regards to everything that you understand, that has structure that you don't necessarily choose, but, you know, it's just that way. Everything from, like, how banks work to countries work and, you know, religions and things like this. You know, everything that you've learned in school and all that. And as you know, your parents are a product of all those established ideals of living. And it's up to you, you know, releasing yourself from the parents to decide if you are able to operate beyond the offering that is grounded. So we can call anybody that decides to invite everybody to the world. Let's just say we all get shipped off to a Pleiadian world. What would be the first thing we do? We go there and they say, "Well, you know, what's the deal here? You know, how does everybody get along? How does this work? You know, how do people interact? And you know, where, you know, how does your money work? How what do we need to know to live day to day?" And on Earth, there isn't a whole lot of rules, right? I mean, you could basically choose to live in nature and live a holistic, balancing life. I believe, Greg, your mic's live. If you can mute for the moment. And so you can live in Gaia's realm perfectly fine, as many indigenous beings and cultures have. But what was wanted to elevate beyond the simply having a relationship with Gaia alone was to bring more of an experience of creativity from the human's ability to expand through contrast, and that is the place where contrast is literally a catalyst. And if you're on the wrong end of a catalyst, it can feel like something very uncomfortable that you have no control over. And the point here now is moving through this place and time where you're making more conscious decisions about your environment. So that's why you'll want, not want to, but it can be a common experience for many people to go through and understand what was setting up the rules for how humans are to live in the before space. And then as you step beyond that, it's a more of a conscious choice towards what is it that you're going to be vibrating at, what is it that you're actually choosing to live. And many people are still in that discovery place. They're wondering, you know, who am I? What is it that feels right? And there's lots of subtle programming, you might say, that is basically inserted so that there is pre-existing answers to questions you might have about yourself. But there's a lot of open spaces to ask questions about, you know, what life after death is. And that's why there's things like mysteries, like ghosts, and lots of things that just don't add up. This gives you the place to begin to ask yourself what, you know, what feels right for me. Now, it doesn't get any simpler in consideration for the fact that each one of us has a personal dimensional experience. We're each individuals. We each literally have our hearts set on a different frequency. So there's nowhere in the world where 100% of the people are going to have 100% of the same experience or choose to. Literally, space and time gives us a completely different perspective each time, and that's important, right? So, at the same time that we're looking at but the fact that we're all different, we also need to not take any sort of rules given to us by anyone else as the end-all be-all. So even when I'm talking right now, this is not what the rules are. I'm not telling you how it's got to be. I'm not saying, you know, fairies are going to show up at the end of this year, and that's when you can plan on it. All I'm saying is that that is what I'm being told, and that is likely the experience that I'm going to have. And I want everyone to basically allow their mind to chew on these sorts of informations themselves, see how it feels, see if they have a relationship with those from the other realm, the fairy realms and whatnot, and basically begin to play with those. If it doesn't, if it's not on a playful approach, and it's more like we need the you know, the Pleiadians to save us or the fairies to save us, well then you're not likely to have your heart invested in really bringing it forward. You're focusing more on the desperate vibration, which is more of a disconnection of you finding yourself. And since right now it's all about finding yourself, naturally you'll want to have a lighter, more enjoyable experience about considering these things. If you go about it and want facts, you're going to essentially have an opportunity to push yourself away from that, unless you're really able to keep yourself centered and objective at the same time. And there's many people that can, so I'm not judging anyone there. I see that there's a bunch of dialogue going on in the chat room. Larry, is this something you want me to keep track of, or what do you want to bring up?
If you wanted to touch on some of that, we can go over what takes us. I mean, Greg Prescott had mentioned, you know, the Mars situation. He put out an article as far as Buzz Aldrin wearing T-shirts campaign to get your ass to Mars. And, you know, I just think that that's actually been going on, I believe, under in the 1970s, you know, the jump rooms. And, and maybe you could talk about a little bit about how you think that that would be done. Is it that they're trying to go to Mars in a ship? Are they trying to go through a portal, a jump room? I mean, these are all...
Okay, so there is technology that develops portals, okay? Yeah. And that's a very accessible technology. Even though, you know, you look at, you know, between us here talking, I have no idea how it comes to be, right? But it's a technology that that exists. And if it exists, then you can attract... the experience of either accessing one yourself, if that's the direction that will work for you, or to literally go and have that type of technology internally and not require a tool to give you that experience. So if you really want to find a jump rune, or if you really want to go to Mars, trust me when I say you'll find all those things that keep you from going on Mars will show up in your experience, and they may not be anything in context to Mars directly, but there'll be all the beliefs that are in resistance to that reality occurring for you, okay? So those that are letting us know that, you know, the jumps to Mars existed and that there are colonies on the moon, the reason why we have this information is because we wanna chew on that. We get excited about it, we get interested, but there's a lot involved in your world, and not many people, in terms of their mind, are in too many places where they want to fundamentally go and live such a dramatic different reality on a no going backwards type of scenario. We do like to go into other realities. That is essential to the human mind's point of perception. That's why we like movies. That's why we like novels. That's why we like to hear other one another's experiences. But to make it grounded and make it our own, that involves a degree of responsibility. So we'll just put it in this context. You want to go to Mars, then you need to decide how you're going to get there, and you need to decide how you're going to reach those that can help you. If you want to go through technology, you can go through technology. If you want to invite people that will take you there, you can invite people that will take you there. The focus of your mind, let's just say you decide, I want to invite people that will take me there. So what does that mean? Well, currently, your mind only knows that the government's had these capabilities and the technology. Now you got to figure out, how am I going to convince the government to let me go? Well, you got these beliefs as to, you know, why the government is doing it and why they're not doing it anymore. Well, you got to go through all that, and you got to process these, you know, all these doubts. But in another way, you could say, well, let's not make it that complicated. Let's not go through the government. Let's just, you know, see what happens, and I put the intention out, and I put the intention out that this is going to be a functional reality. Why? Well, you know, at that point, just, you know, having that out there, you may want to ask yourself why you want to go to Mars. Is it so that you can come back and say, aha, I was right about the Mars thing, and now you can, you know, shove it on your friends' faces? If that's the reason, you probably got some more to work out. You probably got some internal memories with regards to being rejected by your peers or your friends, and that's the modus operandi. But that doesn't lead you necessarily to the highest perspective of yourself. That may be a step, but right now we're moving through these steps very quickly. It's almost like you know, you can listen to information on the outside. Say, you know, you find out from your mother that you had another sibling that that you never got to hear about that got adopted, and you're like, what? How can that reality possibly be? But because you trust your mother, because you're grounded in your mother, you know, then you can have that reality. Now, if you're not so grounded in your mother's perspective, then you might actually come to her and say, well, give me the evidence, and she won't have the evidence, right? But if you do have a grounding that's in balance and in love with her, then maybe she will have that information. And in other words, sometimes, you know, you'll want to find out, and she'll basically be like, well, I have a little bit of a head start, and I have a little bit of a lead. You go through the rest. And so that's saying, I'm grounded enough to give you the fact that I see it as a fact. And so you basically merge with her fact-based reality, her reality, and you get to make decisions going forward about how involved that will be in your reality. But we don't do this consciously. We're fairly reactive, and that's why we have guides. That's why we have a higher being. That's why we have a lot of beings that are a little bit more in concert with all the physical experiences in this dreamlike reality to bring you what you're asking for, and to help you shift your vibration so that you're a vibrational match to the reality you're intending. And that is really what all this is getting down to. Why are we attracted to the fairy realm? Probably because you have a degree of that DNA in you. Now, why are we attracted to the stories of the fairy realm? Maybe not because you have a degree of DNA in that, but probably because the stories specifically indicate certain things that feel right, that feel liberating, and that kind of passion, that kind of love is what gets us to even bother considering it in the first place. So, you know, I keep getting into further tangents every time I mention this, but where should we go from this point?
Hey, preach it, brother, preach it. I totally resonate with everything that you're saying, and it seems like these things are coming more and more into our reality. We, you know, focus on the extraterrestrial thing, but we've got extraterrestrials, ultra-terrestrials, interdimensionals, and as the veil thins, you know, this thing is just kind of melting together. Now, you know, as far as Mars goes, I don't know if that's some longing in our DNA for Mars because we're...
Well, we have DNA from those that lived on Mars.
Okay.
That's why. We want to... an experience to Mars, for many of us, would actually help us wake up because we do a little bit more like a remembering. You know, when you remember a childhood memory that's fond and wonderful, you're like, wow, yeah, I remember going to Disneyland, and oh, man, now that I think about it, it puts me in a good mood. That's half of what it's about. The other half is some of the things that went on Mars were terrible, actually, really rotten experiences, and Marduk, the asteroid belt planet. And... Yeah.
Just real quick, if I could, before you move on, I mean, and I mentioned this on another show, the thing with Mars, right, all the terrible things that happened, they talk about an asteroid hitting it, a meteor. I mean, I'm convinced it was some kind of a two-civilization nuclear war, maybe something that the Soviets and the United States built up, but it really happened there. And I believe...
No, it was far before that, from my understanding.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Not a war that was propagated by humans in the last 100 years.
Right. I mean, this is ancient we're talking.
Right. Yes.
No, okay. So, it just makes you wonder, and I think that every time we talk and discuss these subjects, it brings up more possibilities, and, we put this puzzle together of just how we are as humanity, and we are so strong and powerful, and people do not realize that, and, people don't consider, and I think it's just coming into the play, like you're saying, considering the DNA factor from the fairy realm. I mean, people talk about star DNA, reptilian DNA, all that. It's just really a melting pot here on the interdimensional.
Mm-hmm. So, do you want to talk about a couple of the other things that I'm able to access regarding Mars, or?
What is your thought on Mars as it relates to the Pleiadians? Do you have any take on that?
Okay, so the Pleiadians are not directly involved in Mars, but they do have a deal of information if you want to hear it from their perspective. Yes. What they want to say is that there is, and there are humans on Mars. There is underground developments quite a bit, but it's not in terms of millions. It's more in terms of tens of thousands of people that are there, both human and half human DNA species beings. A little bit hard to explain with what the halves are, so we'll just leave it at that for the moment. They have a space program that is not getting off the ground. This space program would be, like another version of NASA or something like that there with a lot of suppressed information and technology. But it's not very far off the ground, comparatively speaking. You're talking about, they're still in the excavation phase of things, and they're still trying to integrate technologies that they've received from extraterrestrial trades and things like that. But yes, when you're out in Mars, there's going to be a lot of discussion about the surface and how it looks like there were structures there before. That's basically a degree of the erosion that occurred quite a long time ago when the atmosphere was much more functional. Now, that led to a weather pattern and whatnot that led to overall erosion over a long period of time. But with regards to there being oxygen, there is actually oxygen on Mars. It's just not at the degree of being breathable. What are they doing? They're wanting to make the surface of Mars more accessible. But there's really only a couple key triggers that need to occur that will make it fully accessible on the surface and breathable right away. I can't really situate exactly what I'm being told with regards to the exact triggers that will lead to that, but Mars and the Moon, and including the surface of the Moon, are literally within our lifetimes likely to be colonized extensively. I mean, extensively. But with regards to the Pleiadians' interest in Mars, all they need to do is make sure with those other races that are in the solar system that the space program that's being developed there does not become one that can be used against the awakening of mankind. So, they do things like, mess with electronics. They do things with, slow down development of certain things. They prevent weapons from being transported there, things like that.
Yeah, fascinating. And in fact, Greg Kress, the 5D radio, the My Strong Creator, I've asked him that question about Buzz Aldrin in the future of the hereafter. And was this a certain rat's easy gift? If so, why? I mean,
Well, if you're asking me to ask what Balz Aldrin was going through, I would have to connect to his field.
Right.
And if you want me to take a moment, I can see how well that'll go.
Yeah. If you could hook up.
Because that would be the fastest. Okay, so Balz Aldrin has a great deal of information, and there are a couple, we'll call steps that need to follow through with regards to how government is conducting itself, and in the sort of way that the government has gone past a degree that is considered too far, so to speak. And what he will say next that he knows about will basically help bring a lot of information out in a way that can't really be stopped because it's being asked for. When you understand when a whistleblower has to say something, they can be blocked, as you know, by the cabal sources or whatever. But at the same time, if it's the right time, and if humanity is asking, if there is a collective intent for his word to get out, then that basically overwrites the intention of the ruling structure. You see, when the global structure or just large numbers of people in general, they can get and they can fund whistleblowers to say things and get that information out. Like they might try to stop his radio broadcast, they might try to stop his airplane if he's going to a location, whatever. They can route him around the world and, make it difficult if they know that he's planning on saying something. So on one level, he still holds a place where he does have things to lose and family and has his own concerns. So he's going through his own desituation process with regards to his beginning to follow his heart more and letting go of programs. And the information is going to come forward through him, not directly through me. But it is definitely the comment of him saying, get your ass to Mars, that is literally saying there is a lot of information unknown about Mars. And it's not to get people to leave and to sort of like escape or run away. It's more or less to unlock that there is a vast amount of information should more people get interested in putting more observation and more research into what's going on Mars. I mean, literally, there already is a lot of information I'm getting. If that information would just be requested enough to get around to people who are basically beginning to question everything. Now, Mars is not meant to be a catalyst, from what I'm understanding. It's not meant to be, just tell the story about Mars and everything will cascade down from there. At least in my experience. But it is a puzzle piece that talks about a completely different understanding of how things are established and what the current status quo is. And once you have this current status quo, then it's okay to be like a rebel and start choosing your own reality and start inviting those who are vibration your reality to support you and for you to support them and get into a place where expanded information on things like Mars and lots of secrets can come out. What a lot of people are going through right now is still this sort of experience where they're looking at government and sort of looking at like their parents, when you're young and you're 15 years old and you want to run away from home, but you still don't know what to do about money. You don't know how to take care of yourself. You actually have a relationship with your parents. On some levels, you feel you have some sort of commitment, but you don't know what it is. You have a connection. We'll call it an empathy bond of sorts, and that's because many of those that are running the government are not, not just government, but many levels, we are a part of them, and they are a part of us. And until we understand more of that, it's going to be hard to really, jump ship on our own ship and and account for what we've jumped ship and left behind. So there's lots and lots of stages that the Pleiadians perceive that people at different levels on their path will go through, but there is going to be some significantly more intense catalytic experiences yet to come, according to them, through to the end of the year, that are going to push people in a faster direction to begin trusting their hearts. And a good deal of the Pleiadian star seed awakened people, practicing spiritual, developing people, is that they're going to have a context for these people who are going to have, we'll just call them very strained consciously to feel like they can make it. If you look back at a timeline projection that, the original apocalyptic predictions in many different realms spoke to a mass loss of life, that the population was going to drop. And there's all these different possible timelines for that. Well, that is from the perspective of when that came out, that was under the assumption that people were too rigid to begin to expand their minds, actually. And in that timeline, that was a functional truth. Should nothing have continued to develop in a spiritual way. But we are. We're much more aware of our circumstance, much more aware of who we are, even if it still seems vague and seems to be hidden behind a veil. We're still much, much more advanced in this place and time than we ever were before. And I'm speaking about myself, and I'm speaking about you and most of the listeners here, really. And and that's basically where I stand on that. Buzz is going to talk, and he's going to talk alongside, and this is the most likely reality spectrum of this, or timeline, is he's going to not speak alone. He's going to speak with literally an army of people standing between him and anyone that wants to stop him. So it's going to become not necessarily rebellious. It's going to appear rebellious on one level, those who begin to support him and say, this is the way I want disclosure to occur. And there will be those who will be like, you know what, he has a right to live his life. You know, whatever he chooses to say, he has a right to say it. So just the freedom of speech demands that no negative circumstance come into his reality, and he's got to cope with that. Currently, he's aware of realities where people get off to with no good explanation, and you know, maybe their families do know, but you know, the families don't have a way of getting that information out as to what's really occurring. So he doesn't want to literally leave the planet, because his purpose is not only to speak his truth, but to continue to live and thrive, experiencing, you know, what comes of what he's saying. He really does want to see what he experienced and what he knows to be a more functional reality, rather than a more like a reality that involves lots of issues. He wants these to be solved. He wants resolution. He wants, well, in some cases, restitution. But that's where his vibration is very potently aware to me.
Do you see the situation where you know, picking up, like you're saying, shit picking up, like even coming out here and there? Greg Prescott wrote a great article on this. Do you see this thing as starting off as, you know, people say that's just buzz out there saying his thing, but do you see this thing picking up steam? You mentioned all the conversation with him and the naysayers standing with him. I mean, do you see this thing as something that kind of picks up steam in the media and starts off as ha ha ha, that's just buzz, but it'll be like a story that won't go away?
Well, that's up to you, and that's up to every listener.
Right.
And what stands in the way of buzz being a catalyst or not is things within your own vibration, okay? It's within my vibration, too, because I haven't seen it happen either, okay? And I'm honest about that. Directing your intent is very important. Directing that is the way you feel most comfortable the shift coming about. Now, you can give up on how it happens. If you want, you can say, like, I don't care. I don't give a damn. I want buzz, and I don't care what shows up afterwards. I don't care what kind of trouble we get into as a humanity when, you know, shit hits the fan like that. You can just have faith that humanity will pull itself together. And then, you know, no longer will the men in black become an issue. No longer will people come into your house and making you shut up by, you know, busting your kneecaps become an issue. Because no matter what, you're foundationally aligned with your heart, which is the point at which your future is found. Okay? Your heart helps you find what feels best. And what I want to say about people in the experimentation phase of their heart right now is that they're trying to trust their heart. But you can. You really can when you've gone through and realized that you're extremely blessed, that the experiences you're going through are everything is synchronistic. Now, you've heard people talk about having these massive spiritual experiences where they say, well, I was all, you know, I was one with everything, you know, ayahuasca trips, acid maybe. They say, I was one with everything, life after death experiences. This is information, okay? What is it that what does it take to be in that experience without going through that experience? It's a state where you're in an observation of no resistance. And the only resistance you'll have is within your own mind, not from without. From without is a response to your current projection energy as directed and sort of curved and managed by your mind's ability to understand and cope. We call it coping because that's the way the mind would like to call barely getting through. But, you know, many people who have a faith-based approach, they can be seen as, you know, wackos. But they're only seen as wackos because the mind has decided that wacko is what you get from being that. Okay? I mean, technically, if you want to talk about entering into another realm with fairies, as I did, you know, I talk to people, and it works. I'm able to explain my truth, and I don't get doubting faces. I don't get puzzled minds. But, of course, I'm not going to, you know, people who I know that are having nothing to do with anything like that. I'm not trying to convince people that don't care about it. I don't want to hear about it, right? I mean, I know plenty of people who don't want to hear about it. So I'm not on their doorstep telling them they gotta, you know, pick up this reality. See, your reality is independent as a timeline. And your experience is the center of everything. Now, I'm not saying everything else doesn't exist, but your interrelationship with everything else is based on your perspective relationship with yourself. So the more you understand yourself, the more that you get in tune of managing it. And it's not really managing it. You're already following as it suits. Your mind is just not playing ball with the fact that you're a part of a larger energetic ecosystem, and that you yourself are the invitation of your experience. Kind of like when you're in your dreams and you sometimes feel you're in other people's dreams. That's still you. You couldn't be there if that wasn't a part of you. So, you know, I go down the street and I trip on a rock and bust my knee. You say, wow, it never happens. I'm the healthiest person. I've never hurt myself. Why did that happen? Well, to give you information about yourself. You're not the person that goes around. You don't have a busted knee your whole life. But incidentally, in context, or even synchronistically, that has a relationship to what's going on in your life at that time. So, I know I'm getting in a direction that can be kind of stretched out and can be kind of, you know, sounding preachy. I am speaking from my experience. I'm saying I'm owning this myself right now, and I'm not wanting to place anyone into a place where they're needing my information so that they can't consider these concepts by themselves. But these are offerings because if you are in love with what's coming up and what I'm saying, then you and I probably share common timelines. And there are timelines that are literally large numbers of people are involved on. We call these consensus timelines, and there is an overall consensus timeline. And this is the one where the mind agrees that there is only one time and place and space and only one truth, and truths are hidden. I mean, from the consensus timeline perspective, it appears that lots of people are doing wrong and a lot of people are doing right. But in fact, everybody needs to live their life and to discover themselves. You know, even as I'm saying this, I'm still discovering myself. I'm speaking to myself as I talk to you. As much as, you know, the thoughts in your mind hearing this, you're recognizing what I'm talking about. Now, probably enough for that. I see a stream of questions. I want to make sure that I'm able to get in and follow this. So just, Larry, is there anything that in there that I should know about?
Yeah, I'm listening to you as well. Tim Walling, I know, he was listening in.
Uh-huh.
He was wondering about the moon factor and the reincarnation cycle trap that we're in. I mean, uh-huh. you discussed Mars.
Uh-huh.
And how that relates.
Okay, so the moon is a neutral zone. It's a... I don't know how to describe it, but it's an environment that is provided, like Earth is also a neutral zone, but not doesn't appear that neutral to, you know, since we're here. But the moon is a neutral zone where any number of beings are allowed to live within the moon and have basically landing strips on the other side, so to speak. They're allowed to do that. And there's lots of space to do that, and those that agreed to live in the conditions for that are doing that. With regards to human government, there is no human government allowed currently. There are human individuals who have left the planet and have not returned who are on the moon. So there are literal humans that have lived here in this lifetime and are living there now as they are having an involvement with those there. Don't ask me for how they do that. I mean, it's a tons of different reasons that are pretty intense, but there is technology and there's many groups that live there according to the Pleiadians. Now, when I look at the imagery that they're giving me, the moon is going to be a really easy puzzle to unravel once anybody spends a decent amount of time there, which I mean, you know, research and whatnot. But if you decide to travel to the other side, which is functionally for some reason, I don't know why, people are not meant to do that right now, you will get a lot of answers because there is a consensus we'll just call ET experience over there. And a lot of them are not necessarily like super technological, and a lot of them actually would prefer to not have a relationship with humans, but that's not going to be an infinite situation. But there isn't wars on the moon, but there are definitely lots of spacefaring beings that have communities there. Did you have other questions about the moon that maybe I can answer through Pleiadian's perspective?
Yeah, exactly. Do you think that the moon was put here after the Earth was created for some reason? I mean, the Earth created, it was going along, was the moon put into a direction afterward?
No, it was put into afterwards. It's not part of the Earth. It had to have a minimal amount of physical substance that was that could relate to the Earth, so that it can be a possible in orbit as a large body. In order to be in orbit, it had to have something in something that's not entirely foreign. But the moon was apparently brought from outside the solar system. You could call it a functional looking post to have relations with the Earth while not having ships out above the surface of the Earth. You see, in past times, the ships were much more visible, you see, and so if they were to hang out behind the moon, then you wouldn't be distracted by all the ships. But in past times, ships were much more available to our consciousness, okay? Ships are actually very available to the consciousness of babies when they're born. In fact, a lot of things, including fairies, much more available before the vibrations of what we call the human conscious experiment begin to become integrated with them. You're much more of an infinite soul in those sorts of ways. However, in order to play ball, in order to develop as a human, you're going to have to continue to follow into the established grounding vibrations that both human culture and Earth reality provide you. You know, much like Gaia and we'll call Earth culture, they're kind of like your mother and your father with regards to giving you a space to experiment with yourself and to discover yourself. So, and the balance is not ever going to go entirely living with just Gaia. And the balance is never going to go entirely to just living off of government or something like that. There's a balance, as there is a functional value in both. But increase your relationship with Gaia if you feel your life is a bit too bureaucratic, and you'll begin to find a natural balance having a relationship with Gaia as a person, you know, as a conscious being that does hear you and does involve itself with you, similar to a guide, and you'll begin to see a lot of things really sort of lift off for you as you begin to be more a harmonic being in balance with the vibration that Gaia is holding for us in the first place. It's kind of like, you know, I'm living in a house, we'll say Gaia's the house, and I decide I want to become a mermaid and live underwater. Well, this house has air in it. So if I want to be a mermaid and live underwater, I'm going to have to go to a different house that's like an aquarium. Okay? And people here right now and living here are not actually here with the intention to go live in an aquarium or live on another planet, exactly. We're here because everything we could want for generations to come is still to be discovered here. Mostly, and from my perspective, I'm understanding, is because of the other realms and dimensions of Earth will unlock, like, you know, as we started with the Fae realm.
Okay, so basically, another question that came up in the chat was, do you think the Earth was ever even tied, etc.?
Hold on, you're breaking up. So start over.
Yeah, sorry about that. Can you hear me? What I was going to ask was, there was a question in the sidebar in the chat about the Earth never needing the moon for tides, etc. Was that just something that was placed here? I get the feeling these planets are sort
correct.
Of
correct. No. So, the tides are not completely necessary, and yes, the tides are involved in the ecosystem as the Earth has developed with its presence, okay? But moving the moon away and taking it away will be quite catastrophic. If it were to be taken away, it would have to orbit itself out of it, out into a larger loop. You'd have to get into a larger orbital pattern. But it is literally a tool for reflection, and so it's brought a tool of greater reflection for the human to look at itself. Call it the big mirror in the sky, and the more light that you can get into that mirror, the more that you're going to have that sort of reflection. As the sun is also quite integral to our existence. I mean, you could say, you know, maybe technology one day can geo-heat the planet and replace the sun's solar, properties, but that's not going to happen until you literally come to grips with the relationship we have with the sun, too. Okay, every body in our solar system has a functional relationship energetically that literally affects us, just as little people. You say, Jupiter, who cares about Jupiter? It's way out there. Well, that's like saying, okay, how about we just take off five of your toes and live without five of your toes? And you're like, well, that doesn't sound so good. Well, then, yeah, the Jupiter does have a functional purpose in your vibration, and so it has, you know, it must be there. Same thing with the moon. Even though it doesn't have a functional origin in this solar system, it does belong, and it is integrated, and it does have purpose in many ways, as you can see, as you probably understand.
Yeah, no question about it. And sometimes I wonder whether the planets in our solar system, Julian, if they're vacant because they're already ascended. I mean, you take Venus, I wonder if they're completely in 5D. And all these planets, it seems more and more to me, a lot of them could have just been engineered like bioplanets by whoever created them.
Okay, so what's your question?
So, I guess what I'm asking is, most
speaking of the mic, you're going in and out like a wave.
Yeah, most of these planets that are in our solar system, do you think that they had some kind of humanoid life on them at one time, and then do you also think that some of them are already ascended completely into the higher dimensions?
Well, I'm not going to say what I think. We're just going to say from a place of my personal knowing.
Okay.
But I'm gonna sparkle it with what the Pleiadians give me, or sprinkle it, not sparkle it. So the definition you're giving to ascended is iffy with regards to exactly what their experiences are. They live at different levels of density, and therefore also at different levels of dimension, which means they have a completely different experience. What ascended is this place where, in their interpretation, you have a great degree of freedom. You basically have like angel wings, and you can explore as you wish, and you have very little resistance, called negativity. And they both continue, I mean, they all continue, these races, to have negativity. They just wouldn't seem very negative from our point of view, okay? It'd be like something like, I used to make 50,000 a year, and now I'm making 49,000 a year. You know, that's like a crisis or something for them. And you're like, that's nothing. That's nothing, okay? So in retrospect, they live a much lighter, less intense experience. And humans have a very intense experience. But at different points in the beings on those planets' evolution, they did have intense phases, okay? And in some cases, they chose those planets where there was no humans at all or human-like consciousnesses there at all, and they came and they settled there. So there wasn't necessarily on that planet was there a great level of resistance, period, in their lifetime. You know, they basically immigrated there. Now we, if you look at our timeline as humans, we've had really terrible histories, right? You go back to Middle Ages and things like that and slavery and all this. I mean, we're essentially considered ascended to people that look at us 1,000 years ago, okay? But, so you see that, you know, life is easier. You know, life is functionally, a cakewalk, so to speak, right? And it comes to a point here where you'll begin to get an understanding of those other races that are on those on the other planets in our solar system, and the other consciousnesses that may not have a physical body for you to observe with your five senses. You'll begin to have a relationship as you are getting to that level of liberation they have. Earth really is an intense place to be, okay? But that's by design, as it is not only leading humankind to a more advanced state of being, but because we choose to do this in a density that we're in, you end up having a great amount of power and focus over physical density, physical reality. So we say, in another level, we're able to manage a lot of energy conceptually. We're able to handle complexity. I mean, if you look at the room of a Pleiadian, like their bedroom or their house or something like that, and you look at your average American. The American looks extremely cluttered, tons of stuff everywhere. And you say, well, you know, they're just not very zen or something. Well, actually, they can literally give cause for everything that would be clutter. It can give them all purpose. So in what I'm basically saying is that humans are having a very advanced mind experiment to see more and more how much can they how much can the mind work with regards to incredible amounts of potential and work in what is considered a dense reality. Dense literally just means more consistent and more persistent. Things on other in other worlds, they begin to just start vanishing and disappearing and just sort of disintegrating. In lighter densities, that's what happens. And so it gets to the point where you enter into dimensions of densities that are like dreams. You know, like, I had an experience last night, and there was a really cool place that I was in. Does that world exist anymore? It just sort of like, you know, did it get destroyed the moment I woke up? Well, not really. It just goes off to a different level of perceiving it. So, you know, I'm talking at a high level on a lot of these subjects. I hope it's not, you know, getting to the point where I'm losing people too much. But where I'm coming from involves this place where we are moving into a vibration that is more resonant to what our other galactic neighbors are going through. And that is also how they're able to come here more and more and have a more functional experience that does not bring so much contrast to their reality that they would lose themselves. Okay? There are Pleiadians on the observation ship that I'm connected to. And they have observed my life, and they've observed other humans. We'll call them young Pleiadians, like sort of like adolescent and teenage Pleiadians, vibrationally and whatnot. And they have dramatically changed as people through observing human life and behaviors here and all the different things. They're only excited about everything here. Now, the things that they're, if you can call it, not excited, such as all the difficulties we're going through and their empathy for the difficulty we go through, that's the hardest thing that they go through. But they're not directly manifesting it the way we are, as they're not engaged in the same environment that is prepared for that. They're in an environment where telepathy makes it, you know, makes conversations not be so confusing, or makes it not feel like you're not getting through to someone, right? And that's a major issue here, right? Not having telepathy, because, you know, telepathy and levels of empathy are involved. And, you know, when you really know where someone's coming from, incidentally, you can, you know, you can let them or engage with them on a whole nother level. So naturally, their environment is not the same as ours, but the sort of things that they get excited about are all these things that are just simple. Like they're excited for surfing, for riding bicycles. Some of them they can't wait to breathe Gaia's air, like it's some sort of like fairy dust air or something. Like it's just absolutely super attractive. Right? Not unlike the idea of wouldn't it be great to go live under the sea, you know? And you'd be like, well, you gotta prepare yourself for living under the sea because you can't breathe down there, you know? And you gotta use technology to make it work. Well, that's kind of the way the Pleiadians are in terms of coming and living down here, is that it would be hard for them to be in harmony and not get lost. Well, incidentally, they would become human. They would literally become like us. And many have. And those that have decided to come and live here really, really are only able to manage communicating with those that are of a very high vibration like they are. And I don't mean high vibration like lofty and better. I mean frequency. As in they literally have a difficult time communicating on tough emotional subjects, especially when they haven't gone through them. And they don't have a perspective from that place. So, and because when they communicate with you and they say, you don't have to worry about that, that's not that important, you'd be like, screw off, of course it's important. And it was like, that it hurts them that they can't get through to you, that the telepathy and the information that they try to transmit to you is not working. And so there's a functional disconnect there. The telepathy doesn't occur unless you're able to have a true allowing of another person's perspective without the mind imposing judgment on it, right? That's where telepathy begins to take place, when empathy is no longer, you know, something to fear or something that will hinder you, right? And when you are able to have a degree of empathy and yet hold resolute dedication to yourself above anyone else's experience, okay, then no one else's reality need be in a position that hold you from being everything that puts your heart into alignment. So I see we have someone else that's joined. If you could mute for the moment. Don? Yeah, okay. Now, at this point, were there questions that I can get to, Larry, or did we want to let some people that are on the line have a chance to ask questions?
Yeah, definitely. So, and I wanted to actually ask you one last thing, too. Do you think, because I've been thinking about this a lot lately, you talk about that sensitivity that Canadians have, that we have as souls. Do you think that a lot of it, too, that telepathy, it's like we were kind of cut off from, we feel that longing connection, that we're awakening and connected with that. And
yeah, so, yeah. So telepathy was sort of branded as supernatural, and it has, if any group of people focused on redeveloping it, it would take no time, especially now. Like if we got, let's just say, a think tank out of the United States to investigate telepathy, from the perspective that it's totally possible, and not to work from a, it might be possible, but it's totally possible, and all we need to do is find out what it takes for that, they will get it together in a matter of months. I mean, we're talking, you know, the mind approaching this in a sort of genius type of way, okay? Now, what you're referring to, which is that connection, this is a place where we've been disconnected from one another so much so, that telepathy leading into degrees of empathy, which is a part of telepathy, would be very uncomfortable. So this place comes from the place where you feel that you get swept up by the other person's experience. Consciously, we'll just say, people being murdered in Rwanda, you'd be like, wow, that's awful, that's terrible. And if you actually feel terrible about it, well, that's your heart saying, nah, that's not my vibration. Feeling that concept of terrible is not actually true for me. Okay? So therein lies a difficulty in having empathy developing to the level of telepathy. Most telepathy these days are experienced between people who truly love each other and who are connected on a level of lack of resistance, typically siblings, actually, and parents with their childs while still at the child stage before the egos develop to a level that the parents will observe. So, you know, when a parent spends a good deal of time with a child, I mean, like, literally, like, you know, embracing the child continuously, empathy comes easily, and then telepathy can begin coming. And, you know, in some cases, the mind of a child or a baby is not terribly complicated. But there are those connections, and that's, you know, where you get these explanations for, why a mother can sense that her child is in distress and whatnot. But, you know, because they signed up for that in many ways to be an observer of that. Now, will we as a species get to that? Pleiadians are saying absolutely. In fact, it is functionally absolutely integral to be involved in many of the races that are out there. As many of the races that are out there that do not practice telepathy tend to be of a negative orientation, relative, from our perspective, relatively negative. And that is not what we're choosing to attract. So, the ability to have empathy literally means that you can be in acceptance of someone else standing there to a degree of understanding they hold their perspective reality individually and observationally, and you hold your own. When that is clear, telepathy is going to take many leaps and bounds. And, it gets into quantum concepts and things like that. But really, any sorts of experiments that you want to try that lead to telepathy, I encourage, because the Pleiadians encourage it. And although it's not a global practice right now, it is definitely within the next several years going to be definitely catching on. It's going to get really interesting how technology integrates with telepathy, as well as there's only a couple apparently known star races that I'm communicating with that do practice telepathy with technology. And the Pleiadians that I'm in contact with, they do exercise that, and they do have telepathic technology. They literally, don't use a remote to ask a robotic type being to do something. They'll just speak to it telepathically. It doesn't need that kind of instructions. So, does that answer your question? I might have gone on too many tangents there, but
no, exactly. I think what you finished there with, they practice through consciousness. It's their technology is not in matrix based; it's completely through a consciousness based. Mm-hmm. And I agree. It would be almost like using the primitive analogy of a race inventing instead of a vehicle that sucked all the oil out of the earth. They went right to inventing a hovercraft, maybe that use cosmic technology and things of that nature. But what I'd like to do, Julien, if you don't mind, if anybody has a question that's here in the chat, anybody would like to unmute themselves and ask Julien a question, I think that would be great. Is there anybody out there that would?
Yeah, just speak up in the chat or go unmute if you want to do it in the voice approach.
Okay.
All right.
I think I think the thing about your talk is that you really answer all the questions. I'm sitting here trying to calculate questions, and you're answering with every next thing you say, and I really, really appreciate your wisdom on the show. You know, it's just been really great having you here. Is there anything else that you wanted to touch on, or that you?
Well, do you remember we had a question that I asked you that we were going to put second, that we put back on the back burner? Does anybody remember what that is? What that question was?
Yeah, that was about the fear of, you mentioned, that fear that the UFO landing. Right. And that's going to be okay, everybody might have that, but it doesn't seem to you, at least it always has to me, that innately there's something out there, there's something that makes us feel that, or been programmed into us,
See, the thing is, it's like being told there's a boogeyman. If I tell you there's a boogeyman, it's going to drive you insane every time you sleep over a bed that might have a boogeyman or a closet nearby. You're going to go insane, all right? You're going to freak out, and you'll begin to see evidence. You'll start calling shadows boogeyman shadows and things like this, until eventually you end up in a reality where boogeymen really are occurring, okay? That's because you're committed to my reality as someone that trusts me, right? So you trust your parents, and so you follow through the programs. You trust your government, so you follow through with that reality, okay? Now, there is such thing as, parallel realities. This is where you're aware that, the government is both real and it's also not real, right? I mean, you could talk to people, who don't know any conspiracy information at all and say, yes, the government is like everything I ever thought it was. And then you talk with your other friends, and they're like, yeah, everything is totally the opposite of what I thought it was. But there is a middle, there is a place where they're both valid, where they both have a purpose in your existence. When you find that place where both the negative and the positive, so to speak, or the better than, okay, when you're able to see the purpose of why both of those are in your life for you, concentrate on yourself, why they're in your life, then you get to a place where you begin to say, ah, I've learned the lesson that I came to learn about something, and now I can step beyond that. Now I can say, you know, anybody that's harping on something for a long time, that means they're still wanting to unravel that sort of paradox. And the paradox is saying it is both a good thing and a bad thing, but why is it fundamentally important to me as a person? And that involves, understanding yourself, and that involves, understanding, limits that you actually want to release yourself from. As many of us have, functional limits that we don't agree on. I mean, there's lots of things we can say society bred us to think about and do that that just doesn't feel right. And what your mind is going through is this: can I do what I really want to do without getting in trouble or being branded a rebel or whatever? And your mind needs to go through and accept that. Otherwise, your mind, as a conscious logistical logic-bearing perspective, will push back and literally do things like, get illnesses and begin to shut down and, put you in the hospital or get you imprisoned or something, so that you take a moment and sit there and rethink how this is going to work. Believe it or not, imprisonment can be a blessing. Imprisonment for doing what you thought was great is that place where your mind says, well, you know what, I guess my mind really wasn't ready to do this, because I didn't have my whole heart. My mind was still perceiving that I'm going to get caught or something. But there's a place where, the judgment that your parents have of you after moving out of the home just will not affect you anymore. You won't care what your parents think, if you decide to, become gay or straight or something like that all of a sudden. It's like, it really, you accept that your parents had a purpose, and you accept that they now, are only involved in their life, and then whatever you want to do is really up to you. And that's where it comes into. If you are able to demonstrate responsibility, when the, contextual responsibility to your brain and to your mind, well, then you get to have it, okay? And these periods in time right now, there's a vast amount of energy. I mean, I don't know how to explain it. It's like the sun is literally showering angel dust all over us all the time to say, go for it. Be courageous. Try that out. Know that your heart is true. Your heart is a perspective reality. And that's, everybody's got to go through that themselves. And yes, they may have a really great experience. Maybe they go to a workshop and they learn a lot of wonderful things. Oh, that was wonderful. And then they go back to what they call the real life, air quotes. They're like, man, I just went back to my crap, But that's where you're like, that environment suited me better. That environment was promoted my trust because I was around people. But you can shift your environment by revisiting the experiences you had at the workshop, revisiting some time that you had with some people, and you can bring that vibration into the now. You can rearrange your vibration. In some cases, you're like, well, I should do some spring cleaning here. I've got a bunch of things here that make me stagnant in my house. I got a bunch of, maybe it's garbage or maybe it's old things that don't make me feel good about myself, And you do sort of spring cleaning, and you end up in a position where, you've actually lightened up the vibration. Food is also vibration. You're just basically, all food can be turned into light vibration, right? But until you start choosing to do that, the food will serve the way it did, generally speaking. So if you want to uplift your food, you can do that. You can talk to your food. You can, bless your food, okay? It's not just, priests that have the capacity to bless. Everyone has the ability to bless. And it's really, really useful, especially if you get used to it. It becomes very functional and very obvious how effective it is. But don't turn away from the negative experiences you have, as that's letting you know that you're tend to overindulge in a vibration that's not where your heart's really at, So there's both the, in a sense, too positive for the mind to believe it. This is too good to be true, okay? And then there's, this is so crappy, this couldn't possibly work out. And both of those are considered extremes of overindulging a thought that isn't really where you are. Now, you overindulge so that you get an idea of what the limits of your levels of comfort are, once you've got that, you should find yourself in balance or headed towards balance after that, not necessarily exaggerating it. So you can choose to be in balance anytime you want to decide that is where you want to be, because in balance, that's where you're getting just as much contrast as you're willing to digest, right, to discover yourself. And that is, when you discover yourself, that's that tunnel throughway that gives you a connection to yourself at an accelerated, consistent pace, And some people, their personalities don't lend to that. The mind wants drama. It wants waves. They're very fiery or watery and emotional or airy. They'll do it there in their own way. But ultimately, you talk about ascension. That's really this place where, you're quite aware of the value of negativity. But in the moment that you're having a negative experience, you may not, right? You have to own that negative experience before you can basically say you don't want it, right? To not want it, you have to understand exactly why it showed up for you in the first place, in many ways, that's what contemplation's about, and in many ways, that's where we can process these things like limitations and negative experiences slowly if we have faith that we will guide ourselves through it, because our guides and our higher being will give us little bits at a time to help you dissect and get all the pieces of the puzzle, so that eventually get to a place where you're like, yeah, you know what, I'm over that, kind of like a girlfriend you broke up with, many years ago. You're kind of like, I was really heartbroken when we broke up, but now, I can see it all for, it being a good thing, because I can see what, it helped me out and who I turned out to be and all that sort of thing, So, in general. But I got to wrap it up here soon, so...
Yeah, exactly. I was just gonna, I was just about to say, brother. Well, there you have it, Cosmic Sports fans. Exactly. And I just wanted to touch on what you said at the end there, like about an old girlfriend. I kind of related to maybe an old song that used to make a person depressed, and now they can appreciate it for what it is and listen to it, And it's just, when you start seeing the whole picture, it really helps the empowerment, and I'm so grateful for you being on here and coming on, and I do apologize about the technical difficulties that seems to happen when energies blend together of a starseed nature. But Julie, just to wrap it up, where can they find you on Facebook? Where can they find you on the wonderful world of the web? And
well, yeah, so on Facebook, I'm Julien Wells. And that's spelled with an A, J-U-L-I-E-N. You can find me and friend me. I do have a private visibility until you're friends with me. I do have a website, julienwells.com, and there you can find links to my recordings of all sorts of stuff that I've done. I also do sessions with people for an hour at a time. And that you can find on my website as well, or you can go to the link directly is jwsessions.com. julian.simplybook.me. And my email is julian@julianwells.com. So, you know, a little plethora of way of reaching out to me if you have questions or, you know, there's stuff you want to address. I tend to be pretty lax about, you know, answering people's questions on Facebook. If they do that, just, you know, maybe it takes me a couple of days to get to the messages as I tend to get kind of bogged down with all sorts of things. But either way, you know, I love interacting with anybody that loves talking about this stuff and, you know, answering questions as it suits. And, you know, we'll do this again sometime, I'm sure. And as I'm getting to look like this Google Hangouts design, maybe just work out the kinks, you know.
Work out the kinks, incorporate it more as a Facebook style, or maybe there's more voice chat in the threads on Facebook or things of that nature. Yeah, I'm so glad to have you on. And thank you for picking up this basketball. The technology just a little bit, but yeah, I appreciate it. I can attest to everybody out there that really does answer people's questions. He'll get back to you, and you know he's willing to help everybody out on a regular basis. And I will post the links to his website and the various things of that nature when I do post them. So everybody knows where to find me. Everyone on Facebook that has anything to do with Canadians. Julien, thank you so much for coming on the show.
You're very welcome. Thank you, everybody, for joining us.
A big dating game, cosmic kiss to everybody out there. Mwah. Okay. Yeah.